Thank you very much, Shox. I'm Medi. This is Vedi. We are here for the first three games of the day, and I'm looking forward to it, Vedi. It's going to be a lot of fun as we start off with Astralis versus Vitality.
Yep, we should be in for another banger. We only have bangers here in the LEC. They're either long, drawn-out, highly sophisticated games of bangers, or they're high-action, high-intense bangers. You know, it's only great games here.
I'll give you the fact we have some bangers, but we have some mash from time to time as well. And to be honest, having watched these two teams play over the last couple of days, we might be in for a little bit of mash in this game.
I was kind of thinking we might get a bit of a slow one to start off the day, but we have to wait and see. We are going to be jumping into Champions League. So, production, cue the cool music.
It's good. There we go. Into the draft. You're beeping along, bopping along with the music there, Vedius. And we already see Taliyah, 100% pick ban so far in the LEC, has been removed once again. And joining her is Olaf, who is also 100% pick ban so far.
So nothing too crazy. Pantheon also going to join that list. A lot of junglers does suggest that maybe the jungle role is perhaps a little OP, but who are we to say such outrageous things? Lucian all going to be taken off the board. Belitza did, of course, play this yesterday, but a very lane-dominant pick that we've kind of been seeing a lot of here in Europe. Not so much throughout the rest of the world, but still sort of passing on from last year's meta. Kai'Sa, of course, still very prevalent in today's pick and ban, considered probably the strongest AD character right now. Let's see how things are rounded out. We have seen quite a few Thresh bans thrown towards on the red side. Akali, of course, still is open, but it's kind of fallen down in priority. There's things like Gragas, Renekton, also very high priority early game champions, but it's actually going to be Fiddlesticks. Okay, so I'm going to assume that this is a big pick for Zantara, something that he's comfortable with. I'm not sure what his history is on the champion in his competitive history, but if Vitality is banning it, it's clearly got to be directed towards Zantara.
So I am having a quick look through his competitive history. Didn't play it in Season 10, but for some reason in my head, I have it as a pocket pick for him. I can remember writing that in my notes, so not surprised it's being banned away, and there is the Twisted Fate immediately locked in for Astralis. Going to see the Gragas and the Thresh come out for Vitality.
We were talking about this earlier, Medic. Twisted Fate in Europe has something like an 80 to 90% presence, right? It's kind of ridiculous how you are seeing it a lot throughout the rest of the world, but here in Europe, we really value this Twisted Fate pick, its ability to look for those roams, about the level 6 mark, its ability to impact these lanes, and kind of a move away from some of the traditional mages. But I still expect to see them, things like the Orianna, things like the Victor, still also very powerful and prevalent, along with things like the Zoe. But Galio has been a common answer, so we'll see what Vitality do to respond to Nuke Duck's Twisted Fate.
Another answer that we have seen is Sylas can work well in the laning phase into that Twisted Fate. And instead, Vitality going to pick themselves an AD carry. Comp will be going over to the Aphelios. Hasn't played that yet this split. Of course, has played the Kai'Sa and the Ashe yesterday to great effect.
So, of course, when you always look at an Aphelios, the first thing you're going to think about is how long range is the enemy team composition? Yep. Because what Aphelios loves is when champions try to dive on top of him. Now, things like Alistar, things like Hecarim, they do a great job of diving into the face of an Aphelios, so he's already a little bit happy. And notice now that they picked it up on their third rotation on the red side, which means they can ban away some of the obnoxious divers, things like the Camille that lock you away from being able to escape to safety, and Samira, which I actually think Samira is quite a good matchup for the Aphelios. When we saw a lot of prevalence of the Samira early on in things like the LPL and the LCK, Aphelios was often used as an answer to it. So I'm a little bit surprised by that ban, but perhaps they just want to take it off of Jeskla's hands. You would imagine that things like the Jhin are going to be the next big priority pick, but let's see what Vitality look to do with their jungle right now.
Also, Vitality not needing to ban out something like the Galio that can dive onto the backline because the Alistar and the Twisted Fate have already been locked in, and the Galio top is not the most common top lane pick. Instead, we're going to see the Graves come in here for Vitality. Skeens will be piloting that in the jungle, and Astralis need to find an AD carry that will work for Jesper. As you said, Jhin very high up on both of our priority lists, and then they will look towards their top lane as well. Renekton is still open. We've seen a lot of the Renekton Gragas matchup over the last couple of days.
Certainly have. I wonder what we've also been seeing a lot of range champions picked into the Gragas, right?
Yep.
We've seen things like the Lulu,
the Cannon.
Excel. We've also seen the Cannon, yeah. I'm curious as to what Astralis choose to do, because I think that you don't want to voluntarily pick the Renekton into it, especially against an Aphelios. I'm not a fan. You know, you already have Aphelios, Graves, Renekton. You're just kind of making their lives easier by picking a champion like that into that, so I'm personally not a massive fan of it. They could go for a ranged top laner. I think it's a little bit of a gamble, well, obviously.
White Knight used to play a bunch of Gnar, and that could work a little bit. Instead, they're going to go for the Orb.
Okay, I actually quite like this, because I think it kind of facilitates the dive and gives you that long-range engage,
yep,
which can then set up. So if that Orn ultimate hits or maybe burns a flash from the Aphelios, maybe forces the Lantern out early, then you can use things like the Twisted Fate ultimate and the Hecarim ultimate to dive onto the backline. We're going to get Melitza on his LeBlanc. For those not familiar, Melitza is a very big LeBlanc player, one of his big comfort picks, and it's going to be exciting to see him on this champion, because when he originally joined the league, a lot of expectations were that he was going to be another superstar mid laner, that carry style player that once he gets ahead, he can kind of run away with the games. And while we haven't had many opportunities to see that, of course, Vitality did suffer from a lot of issues last year, both internally and externally. So coming into this year, fully prepped, ready to go. They kind of won one so far this split, and now he's going to be put onto his comfort, and you kind of have to expect he needs to get ahead on this LeBlanc. You want to try and pressure that Twisted Fate. You want to be putting in positions. You can match him in a side lane later on. I'm really interested to see what itemization Melitza goes for, because I have not seen many LeBlancs on in Season 11 and kind of the direction they usually go.
On to Summoner's Rift we go. Astralis looking for their first win in the LEC. Of course, the organization changed from Origin in the offseason, and now they are sitting at 0-2 across this Super Week so far. Vitality picking up a win against Misfits yesterday after losing on day one in what was a bit of a mess of a game against Schalke. They'll be looking to be a little bit cleaner here. And with Melitza on his signature LeBlanc, a 70% win rate on it over the course of his competitive career, you have to expect a lot of eyes will be on that mid lane.
Yeah, and I want to watch this LeBlanc a lot, because I think that one of the problems Melitza has is he doesn't have... So LeBlanc, I think, is one of those champions that can set up her jungler well thanks to her chains. You have the double chains as well once you hit level 6, but when you pair that up with a Graves who can just bring damage to a lane, I think that should they ever burn the flash of the Twisted Fate early, his life is going to be miserable. So I want to see how much investment we get into the mid lane. Can Melitza use his priority mid into potentially roaming down towards the bot? Now, before Enchantment Select, I talked about like what kind of itemization we can expect. I haven't seen a huge amount of LeBlancs, but I did a little bit of quick research, and it seems that the Luden's Tempest is the priority. You go into the early Sork Boots and then a very early Void Stack, so you kind of get that maximum penetration type of build, which almost gives you true damage, especially at that two item spike. So I think it's really strong. It's going to give that LeBlanc a lot of power when you get to those two items, and I think that that's what we're going to be keeping our eyes on and tracking as the game progresses. But as with all early games, we need to see where the junglers started off. So it seems that both junglers are going to be looking to mirror each other for the time being. But as Comp and Lebrov will look to slowly start to get that priority in the bot lane 2v2, Skeens is going to be better set up for that early Crab. But the Twisted Fate is pushing in the mid lane as well. So that bot Crab is definitely going to be a big point of contention within the next minute.
And as you can see in the bottom lane, Comp and Lebrov do have the push, so they can work their way up towards that just a little bit easier. White Knight pushed in the top lane as well. Seems like Vitality have priority in a couple of these lanes. Skeens is working his way across towards the mid lane, but was spotted out on this ward that had already been placed by Nuke Duck, and now will wander through the lane. Very obvious where he is for Astralis, but he is on his way down towards his blue buff and then that bottom side Scuttlecrab.
Ooh, if we have a quick look at this mid lane, you can see Melitza set up a very comfortable freeze. And for any mid laners that have been in this position before, as Twisted Fate, you really don't like it. The bright side is you know where the Graves is because he just ran through the lane. But if you didn't have information on the jungler, you'd feel very uncomfortable because you can see how far past the midway point in this lane you are. And he's kind of playing up towards the top side. He has a ward on the bot. He knows that Graves is going to be on that side of the map. So he wants to be as far away from the enemy jungler as possible while he tries to get farm and do what he can.
And look at how easy this is for Skeens now. He knows that his mid laner can come across easily. He knows his bot lane is pushed in. Bot side Scuttle is just his. Like, Zanzava was on this side of the map doing his Krugs, and he didn't even path towards the river. Instead, he said, I'm going to go all the way up to top. He will be able to trade Scuttle for Scuttle because of this. He's not on the side of the map that perhaps he was aiming to be.
But I really like how Melitza is playing this 1v1 right now. Zanzara has his eyes set on the top lane. Let's see if he can make a successful gank happen. Looks like for now, nothing is going to really come off the back of it. Maybe he wants to alleviate some of the pressure from White Knight. But the TP has already been invested by Nuke Duck in the mid lane. He's come back with the Dark Seal. And looks like a trade of teleports from Melitza. I'm keeping my eyes on the jungle minimap right now. I see that Hecarim is hovering around the top side as the wave slowly starts to bounce back in Melitza's favor. But nothing too much going to come off the back of it. All right, so no early huge jungle intervention, no crazy skirmishes. They had the trade of Scuttlecrabs, bot lane going in favor of Vitality, mid lane going in favor of Vitality. And I think this kind of ties back to what Deficio and Quickshot were talking about on the analyst desk. This Vitality squad is just kind of a team comprised of very talented individuals.
Oh, definitely. Like, if it weren't for all of the visa issues last year, I think we would have seen a lot more of Melitza's true skill ceiling in the mid lane. And then you bring in people like Shigenda from AGO Rogue, who have just consistently performed well at an EOL level.
I think even last split, we were talking about how you could start to see the potential of these players. And unfortunately, it just didn't quite come through until later on. And no. I was quite happy to see Shigenda join the roster because one of my criticisms of Cabochard is it often felt like the drafts were built towards him, but the team struggled to really enable him. And even when he was ahead, he couldn't really do much off the back of it. So yeah, having some fresh blood, having a new face for the Vitality squad, I think is refreshing. And again, they could have won both their games. It was a very unfortunate game on day one. I believe it was against Schalke.
It was.
They were so close, and it was just a slight blunder that really cost them. And I think that they've already showed great promise here in this very first week.
I think it comes back to a little bit of what they were talking about in the AD earlier, as Melitza gets chunked out just a tad. Chains are going to come down. Both Nuke Duck and Melitza will walk away slightly wounded from that trade, but it comes down back to that, what is a good day one composition idea? Because Vitality's comp on day one was a lot of poke, a lot more hanging back and then trying to engage when you can, whereas sometimes you just need a comp that can go forward as a unit, that is cohesive just impressing its ultimates. And when you get that, it's a lot easier for you to get over the nerves of, you know, week one of the LEC.
I think when we look at the scaling, like, in my opinion, I think the Vitality do have the slight edge with the Aphelios on the composition with the Graves as well. With the front line that they're gonna have with the Gragas, the amount of disruption it's gonna be able to provide, I think that kind of the responsibility for Astralis falls on this Twisted Fate being able to find these plays early on, being able to move to a silent. He has now hit level 6, but with Melitza also doing the same, like, there are going to be these windows where you have to try and force something, otherwise later into the game, this LeBlanc is going to be able to match you in a side lane. This LeBlanc, as long as the TP up, is going to be able to answer. And this LeBlanc is also difficult to catch, because even if she is a side lane, maybe you TP to it, you know, LeBlanc into the Ornn, oh, we send the TP, the Twisted Fate there, try and collapse. I have two dashes and my flash. It can be very difficult and obnoxious to have to lock down. So let's see where Astralis looks to go. We can see Twisted Fate already moving up into the top river. Promise Q has also joined Nuke Duck, so they are looking for that level 6 potential play. The Twisted Fate ult comes through.
Destiny Gate's gonna come in.
Blue card!
Ah, Nuke Duck locks in the wrong color, but Shigenda's still on the wrong side of this fight. Nowhere really for the Gragas to go. He's not gonna burn his flash. Nuke Duck gets the red as well, trying to cycle through all the colors before he's allowed to pick a gold, but they will get first blood in the top lane.
Okay, so you could make an argument that that was intentional because he knew that with the combined crowd control of the Hecarim and the Ornn, that he didn't need the gold card, so he went for the higher damaging blue card. I'm saying that it is a possibility, or he did just misclick. It may have just very well been a misclick, and he did just draw the wrong card, okay? I'm just saying that there is a world where he was like, I just want to maximize my damage. So it's been said, you can draw your own conclusions at home.
We've got a European Reginald on our hands here, Medios.
Astralis have drawn first blood, which is exactly what they needed. That CS discrepancy is, of course, building a little bit in the mid lane, but it doesn't matter because Nuketech did get that kill, and now they just kind of need to keep this momentum going. Killing Jagenda doesn't really do a lot in the grand scheme of things, but getting a kill onto Nuketech, accelerating that gold lead, getting to a point where he can continue to move around the map and look for more plays is exactly what we want to see Astralis do.
Yeah, it really comes down to now how Nuketech uses this advantage, because he has fallen 19 CS down in lane because he left the lane. Bot lane comp is ahead of Jeskler by about 20 CS as well, so yes, he's got the kill. Yes, he now has these Merc Treads picked up and can look to roam around the map a little bit more as Melissa steps forward into him. There's the gold card from Nuketech, but not in range to lock down the LeBlanc.
Vitality's bot lane also seeing a window to roam up. Gonna help to get the push, but also cover Skeens as he looks to secure the first Rift Herald. And this objective control from Vitality early has been great. I'd love to see them use this Rift Herald either bot lane or mid. If you can take that mid tower, I think it does make things a little bit harder for Nuketech to be able to roam around on the Twisted Fate. Alternatively, you can just funnel more gold into comp, try and get that Aphelios to those item spikes that bit earlier on. Regardless, you can see right now Skeens is pathing towards his bot side jungle. I would like to see him clear those camps, maybe go for the bot Scuttle Crab, and then either look for a bot play. But with the wave kind of stacking, they may not be able to do this, as we can see Zanzara moving into the bot river. And yet, it seems that with bot lane having prior, with Melita looking to reset as well, this river control is going to be in favor of Zanzara for now.
Lobov's just being a nuisance here. He's not going to be able to do anything against Zanzara, who picks up the Scuttle Crab. He went for the early plated steel caps on the Hecarim. Of course, all the movement speed you get just multiplies the amount of damage you can do on the Hecarim. So not too surprised that he's decided to get that instead of completing out his first major item.
This is quite interesting. We talked about the Loon's Tempest being the expected first item for the LeBlanc, but it actually looks like she's going for the Liandry's.
Yeah.
Instead, you can usually identify between the Fiendish Codex or the Blasting Wand between Liandry's and Ludens. So going for a bit of a different typical itemization, not going for that early penetration instead. You will have that haste mythic passive instead, a little bit more cooldown reduction, get that greater rotation of spells, and you also have that burn effect. Can be pretty valuable when playing against a tank like Ornn up in the top lane. But also, we already saw Quickshot talking about how in Europe here, it seems that the Liandry's is just favored overall by most mid lane champions. Yep. So definitely would like to talk to some pros and get a little bit more insight on their priority for these mid lane mages.
As you said, it does give you just that little bit more damage when it comes to these tanks as LeBlanc looks to try and catch up Promise Q. Jeskler and Promise Q have been very regularly taking these Krugs just to try and funnel some more gold into the Djinn. As we said earlier, about 20 CS behind, Zanzara's now snuck down here as well as Melita works his way down towards the bottom lane. And it looks like Vitality might be making their first proactive play of the game. White Knight working his way through the base, but with the Rift Herald down, there's going to be at least a couple of plates. Vitality have backed away. We're not going to fight any further, and that will be four plates fed into comp.
Okay, so we talked about this earlier on. They had the choice between trying to break the mid tower or funneling more resources onto comp, and they've decided to go for the Aphelios. You can see he has a 600 gold lead. Thank you very much, observers. But the Twisted Fate's still doing very well in the mid lane match. And Hook lands
onto Zanzara. He's going to use the Onslaught of Shadows to get away. Promise Q has a flank position here. White Knight stayed on the bottom side of the map because there is an Ocean Dragon available for them. Here comes the Call of the Forge God, and the lockdown on comp is undeniable. Promise Q gets the second kill for Astralis of this game, and Melissa's working his way down from mid as well, but it's a 4v5 now in favor of Astralis. Looks like Nuketech's actually going to back away. I wonder if he has teleport available from the Sunseer spellbook, because he's got to join the fray soon. Promise Q going in once again. LeBlanc got over the wall. The curtain call doesn't quite connect as LeBlanc steps towards the side, and Promise Q has already fallen. Melita now knocked up by White Knight. He's going to jump across the wall as well as Skeens retreats down towards the bottom lane, but he is caught with the root. Not quite enough damage from Jeskler as Skeens flashes away.
They're dead.
Nuketech here with the gold card. Skeens nowhere to go as Zanzara's going to chase him down. Jeskler now looking for the damage on Melita, who's caught underneath the tower, but Zanzara falls. So does White Knight, and Jagenda just comes in and happily accepts this kill on the AD carry.
Oh my
word. Gets it.
What just happened? That whole play was perfect for Astralis. The Drake should have been their primary goal. They got the kill onto comp. They were able to find a couple of picks, burn a couple summoner spells, and they could have just turned around, gone for the objective. But now they're going to lose so much off the back of that. White Knight's going to lose so much farm up towards the top side of the map. Like, let's... That was absolutely crazy. When we have a look at the replay, let's kind of follow along, and because I think that Astralis overall just overcommitted to the play. So here we can see the original flank from... Oh, so we're after the flank. Promise Q gets that initial pick onto the... Aphelios, that's the word that I was looking for. And then you can see that here, Skeens gets this punishment onto Promise Q as the rest of the team is in a position to follow. And again, you're kind of just seeing Vitality getting chunked out. And this is where they should just back off. They should just be happy with the picks that they've gotten, but they get to... Hungry for kills, Medic. They see these low health bars and they're thinking,
smokescreen.
Hey, this is doable.
The smokescreen means they can't see him.
Of course, but then this also just buys time for Militza to just then come from the flank and be able to pick up these kills because Zanzara is now stuck underneath the tower. Jeskla has no escape, and Nuke Duck, he can offer zero in this situation. So, like, this was just too much greed from Astralis. It was a great smokescreen, but I think that Astralis should have just turned, taken the Drake and backed off because they kind of got everything that they wanted there. And now you look at Militza. We talked about how you want to avoid giving all this power to the LeBlanc, and now she's 2-0-2. She has the mythic item already, and Vitality looking very powerful 14 minutes into the game.
And you can see the gold has gone from being pretty much even to now 1,300 in Vitality's advantage. The Ocean Dragon still stands on the rift, and Vitality can work their way across towards that one if they want soon. Comp, though, with LeBrother on the top side of the map, so they're probably going to wait a little while before they look for that next objective. Nuke Duck, we said early when he got that first kill, he would need to be the key carry here for Astralis. He'd need to use that Destiny to get around the map. He's building up towards the Rocket Belt. He's 2-0-1. And when your enemy laner is as fed as Militza, you really need to keep them under wraps.
Definitely agree. Notice that Astralis are able to get this free Drake because Comp and Lebrov went up towards the top side of the map. They decided to just move away from that objective entirely, instead try and trade it for another tower. So this is going to be a nice amount of gold going into his back pocket. Notice how Lebrov also stayed away from Comp, so yep, all of that tower gold will go to them, and they're going to focus on this Rift Herald. We already talked yesterday, Medic, about the second Rift Herald not always being as valuable as the first one, that's for sure. But depending on how early you can utilize it, you can really open up the map, then start setting up some deep vision, start looking for picks with this LeBlanc. And one of the things I love seeing from LeBlanc players is, oh, hang on, a bit of a trade, kind of all over the map right now.
Teleport coming in, the smite was used by Skeens. Rift Herald secured by Vitality, but the eye still sits there. Teleport behind here from Shigenda, as he is forced to jump his way across the wall. Destiny from Nuke Duck. Where's he going? Straight onto Militza, trying to catch the LeBlanc out of position. Zanzara diving in, but Militza jumps back. However, the rest of Astralis are just waiting for him with open arms. The stun card's locked, and the shutdown goes to Zanzara.
Vitality are still able to pick up the Rift Herald, but Astralis will get themselves a kill. Now Zanzara knows that he has the support behind him, and he's looking to steal away some camps. A lot of skirmishing happening across the board, and I like the fact that Nuke Duck was able to find that quick punish onto Militza, because all of Vitality was in the top river. They were focusing on that objective, which meant that Militza, when he overstepped, he was in a position to be punished, and that's what we need to be seeing from Nuke Duck on this Twisted Fate. A really good punish from him. So let's have a look at this. You can see that Vitality think they're pretty safe here. They have pressure in mid, while the Gragas also has the TP to join the fight. They secure the objective, and at this point you're like, okay, a bit of a weird E from Y9, not entirely sure what he was doing. Perhaps he expected the Gragas to come a little bit closer, but here we see Militza trying to flank in from the river, but it's actually he who ends up getting collapsed upon. He did not have that second jump away because his ultimate was on cooldown, so he ends up getting punished. That kill going to be picked up by Zanzara on the Hecarim as well. So kill traded for objective. Vitality still with the gold lead. And let's see where they look to use this, this Rift Herald. I guess mid is really the only place for them to use it. You can see the Gragas has already rotated over. They've got the stacking wave, but they're going to be able to take this objective pretty easily without much contest.
I mean, you said earlier, Vedius, that taking down the mid tower and keeping the Twisted Fate perhaps further pushed back in the lane can be effective. Of course, a little bit later than you'd want at the 17-minute mark, especially since Nuke Duck is happy in a side lane now. He's not even laning in the mid lane anymore.
You're kind of at that point now where the Twisted Fate doesn't care too much about the mid lane, and like you're at the point in the game as well where the map starts to open up a lot more, but he's also completed his first item, and so with the teleport and his flash available, like, it's less of a stress. It's more like in the early game when you're looking for those initial roams, those initial ganks, working with the rest of your team is when that mid tower is so much more valuable. But With a lot of these added towers go, you have to note that Vitality right now have a two structure advantage. That bot lane tower is kind of like you just have to breathe on it and it'll knock over. So that'll be 3 towers to 0. And again, kind of credits to Vitality and their individual laners. Last year, they did showcase some of the promise that they have. And I think already early on, the split as Promise Q goes in.
It tries to dive onto the bomb. Going to pop the Unbreakable. Will hits the call to the Portuguese. The White Knight looks for the flank position. Promise Q just about alive, but eventually goes down to Skeens. And now Zanzara is not in the best of positions off towards the top side of this fight. Melita's trying to dive in. Remember, no tower here as the chains land onto White Knight. Zanzara still has a flank position and the Onslaught of the Shadows. He could go in here. He's looking for the engage on all five, but Shigenda's already killed White Knight. Only hits one with the fear. LeBrov able to walk away, but instead Jeskler dives forward with the Cloudburst and gets a kill. The curtain's open, but this shouldn't be taking it down anyone else as Skeens flashes away from the gold cart.
Bit of a weird fight, Menik. It felt like that Astralis just tried to force a 5v5 in mid with no real objective in mind. Like, let's have a look at this. So notice that pretty much everyone is here except for the Twisted Fate. Like, LeBrov, I don't even think is out of position. I think that Astralis just tries to force something a little too hard for this brawl in the mid lane. And as you can see at the beginning of the fight, things don't go too well for them. I think Vitality could have just chosen to disengage at this point in time, but they think, okay, we can actually keep the chase going. And this is where Vitality are now overextending just a little bit. Of course, while they do end up with the kill advantage, a lot of summoner spells end up being burnt, but this doesn't really result in anything. Nothing really changes in terms of the map state. When you look at the minimap, you can see the midway or the bot lane is stuck in the middle, the top wave stuck in the middle, the mid wave is going to get pushed out and cleared by Astralis, but then going to get answered. So a bit of a random fight.
Yeah.
Didn't really amount to much, aside from a lot of summoners being burnt, and this could be good for the LeBlanc a little bit later on. But yeah, a bit of a weird fight.
It was very odd because I was looking at the side waves just before the fight happened. I was like, why is no one top getting this wave? Why is no one bot getting this wave? And then everyone was just in the mid lane, yep, with the dragon still 2 minutes
like,
away.
It could have made sense, you know, if like Astralis had like a pushing wave top and then there was like a huge wave that was like getting crashed or like lost. But yeah, those kind of fights definitely a little bit odd. Either way, kind of like looking now at the map state, you can see the Vitality's focus is clearly on the next Drake. Cloud Drake. This is probably one of those comps where you don't get as much value out of it. The movement speed will be valuable with the soul for someone like LeBlanc roaming, looking for picks, of course. But when you have such kind of low cooldown ultimates pretty much across the board, the ultimate reduction is not as valuable as it could be compared to a few other comps. I think that when you look for Astralis, if they were able to get that soul, then I think that they would get a lot more value from it, especially when you have such long cooldowns with things like the Ornn ultimate and the Twisted Fate ultimate. So let's see if they're able to turn things around later on. Of course, slight Drake advantage over in favor of Vitality. But the map is going to kind of reset into neutral now. The trade was Astralis secured that tier 1 in the top lane. The Baron is going to be spawning soon. I don't expect this objective to be the highest point of contention this early on into the game. But now we're kind of looking for these picks. We should start to see champions like LeBlanc utilizing Fog of War to look for picks. And don't be surprised to see LeBlanc's kind of like hovering behind lanes, perhaps trying to move into pockets of vision in the enemy jungle, in the river, to try and catch enemies out of position. Because that's what you really want to be doing with LeBlanc. Later on into the game, a lot of people think of her as an assassin champion. She's definitely a poke champion, you know. Jump over a wall, QR, goodbye HP, then kind of dashes back over. Now that 5v5 doesn't look as favorable for you because one of your targets has kind of lost so much HP, and then you look to repeat that process over and over and over again.
And because vision is so important, I do just want to highlight something that I've watched Vitality do over the last couple of days, and that's they put LeBrov in a really good position to clear out a bunch of vision. Actually, it looks like they're going to have a fight, so I'm going to bring that down just for a second. We can talk about it after this fight goes on. As Promise Q is... Whoa, okay. You talked about someone getting chunked out. Promise Q running the phase rush really squishy on the Alistar, and you can see the rest of Astralis just have to back away.
But it kind of highlights what we were talking about,
exactly.
Right? The LeBlanc utilizing these pockets of vision. In the river, they had these control wards, and Promise Q, it's kind of his responsibility to phase check, to be able to move into these dark parts, get a little bit of vision down, but then Melitza's there, ready, gets the damage, and then all of a sudden, you gain so much more control. So, well played there by Melitza. Having the Void Staff completed second, you have so much damage at this point in the game as well. This is where I really think LeBlanc really starts to pop off, likely working towards the death cap next. But as you kind of alluded to earlier, Minute, great vision control from Vitality, especially up towards the top side of the map, where they have that push in top and in the top river.
And the reason they have such good vision control is how much LeBrov does on the map. His vision score only second in the league. Wards placed per game is at the top. Wards placed per minute, sorry, and his control wards per minute. He is first in the league for all of these. Of course, support stats can be a little bit fluffy at times, but I do want to highlight watching LeBrov play, watch how much vision he clears out, because he's truly a master of creating darkness on the Rift.
I think that Lebrov is a pretty interesting player, especially when we look at him last year. Expectations were actually quite high. He was praised a lot, and I think that while he didn't quite break into the top three echelon conversation of Haley, Mickey, and Kaiser, yeah, I think that a lot of eyes were still on him, and I think that for his debut split, he showcased a lot. And I know that Thresh is one of his go-to champions, something that he has a lot of success on, and I think that already with this Vitality squad, he's starting to showcase his impact and presence on the map. Now, if we kind of show this vision, thank you very much, observers. You can see how much topside vision is in favor of Vitality. They have full information on what Zanzara and Nukta are trying to do. They're looking for a deep pick, maybe stealing away some jungle camps, seeing if they can catch anyone off guard. But fortunately for Astralis, this vision is here primed and ready to go.
And we continue at about that 2,000 gold difference between the two teams. We are starting to see the second completed items on some of these carries. Comp has his Runans complete, Jeskler with the Collector, Lich Bane second for Nukeduck. So we're getting towards those really powerful, more burst heavy points of the game. But the question is, can Astralis find a fight that's actually favorable for them?
Yeah, I think that as the game progresses, it will get a little bit harder. You have a look at that Aphelios. He is very strong, yep, right now. And it was interesting. I was listening to Doublelift's co-stream the other day, and he was talking a lot about the difference between Gale Force and Kraken Slayer, and how personally he thinks that Gale Force is just so much more valuable on Aphelios, especially with the lack of mobility. But Kraken Slayer can definitely give you that much more damage if you're just freely allowed to stand there and hit. So I think Comp is showcasing a lot of confidence within his own positioning, yeah, coming up towards these team fights, and he's also, of course, trusting his support to take him to safety should he need it. But, you know, that additional dash is always something that I think is super valuable, especially on a dive-heavy comp when you have things like the Ornn, the Alistar, and the Hecarim as well.
I think when you have a support like Thresh as well, it's kind of this pocket play style, right? The Thresh is sitting back in the pocket, sitting somewhere slightly safer, and can always just lantern you out of a fight if needed. The Destiny comes out here from Nukeduck. He's on the bottom side, and this was more just about making sure Vitality were not doing the Baron, because Vitality had so much control over the Baron. As Nukeduck goes forward, immediately gets hooked by Lebrov. Call of the Forge God coming out. They look for Lebrov, who flashes away. Shigenda now on the front line, misses the body slam. The lantern's gonna be there for him if he wants to escape. Dragon up in 10 seconds time, Vedius.
So, ooh, Nukeduck does have the card. That's a big stun.
Hook's not gonna hit as well, and you can see the damage coming down onto Shigenda, and the stun was exactly what Astralis needed. Collateral damage, not enough to take down the Hecarim. The curtain call has been used. Nukeduck once again has locked the gold card as Skeens is forced away, and Astralis have a man advantage as they turn their eyes towards their second dragon of the game.
So, this mid lane fight made a lot more sense. Astralis wanted to contest for the mid lane priority. They had Nukeduck in bot, but Vitality had 5 members in mid lane, so they had to bring Nukeduck up to help contest the wave. It was a great hook. Another great hook lands from Lebrov.
White Knight just chunked out. I don't think I've seen an Ornn go down that fast in a long time. The Aphelios well and truly online.
Whew. Okay, so a lot of picks happening and a bit of a mistake from both top laners, really. Shigenda face-checking the river where he didn't have control. Militz, of course, controlling the flank, but now Vitality going to try and use their numbers advantage to start off the Baron. They do have both Graves and Aphelios, so they're going to go through this one quickly, and let's just keep our eyes on Militz in this situation. Actually, we might not need to because Astralis have decided not to contest it. They're just going to give up the Baron for now. And that's gonna be huge. What was a big advantage gain for Astralis, getting that pick, getting the Drake, denying that soul point away from Vitality, has actually gone immediately back in Vitality's favor after, yeah, finding that pick onto White Knight and very quickly converting it into a Baron. So well played there by Vitality, now firmly in control of the game.
Astralis went for the Cloud Drake, decided to give up any pressure around the Baron themselves. Militza now with Baron buff is going to be even more of a threat in these side lanes, Vedius. Talked about how strong he was beforehand. Now he has enhanced minions. He's building up towards his third item as well with that needlessly large rod in his inventory. And Vitality have a 3,500 gold lead with 2 minutes still yet to use these buffed up minions.
Whew. Good stuff from Vitality, and again, I think that I think it's been a bit of an interesting game, largely because like we've seen a lot of action mid lane. Again, the second fight definitely made a lot more sense than the first one. But I think Vitality have done a great job of like continuing to funnel gold onto the right people. It didn't matter if Jagenda was falling behind. They kept funneling resources into the Aphelios, into the LeBlanc. And you can see that now paying off in the experience difference. Comp level 14, Melita level 16, the Baron, of course, helping with that as well. But a lot of gold being put into their back pocket. And now I think that is three items fully done. Excuse me for comp. And he is primed and ready to go to carry this game. Vitality with the Baron slowly working their way ever closer to the base of Astralis.
Nukeduck has completed his rapid fire cannon here as well, though. So those long range gold cards, a very real possibility. And there's no cleanse on comp, there's no Mikhail's on Labrov. So if he does get caught out, he could be burst pretty quickly. But Vitality using the bound up minions just to rotate between the bottom and the mid lane, take two tier two turrets. And they're going to work their way up towards top as well. You can see Zanzara trying to cut this wave, trying to keep Vitality from having any minion support. But those dastardly little minions are going to be there for Vitality to push down the third turret of this push.
I like how Vitality are playing across all three lanes right now. Astralis is kind of, as we talked about, their comp gets a little bit harder to play later on to the game. They now have to try and dive and kind of one-shot this Aphelios when he still has his flash up. And then, of course, you still have all these other threats on Vitality with both Melita and Skeens primed and ready to just one-shot any carry that comes into range of them. So it's definitely difficult for them to play. They're kind of relying on Vitality to make a mistake at this point, or maybe they can contest for the next Baron, which is likely what Vitality is going to wait for. Now that they've taken all the tier 2s, only the base left to break. So it's kind of just a matter of time now from the side of Vitality. And it just comes down to how cleanly they can execute. Of course, they've been in a similar position when they played against Schalke, and they weren't able to close out the game.
Only 48 hours ago, Vedias, they struggled to close it out from this position. So we'll see if they have learned over the last 2 days or whether Astralis still have a chance to pick up their first win here in the LEC. Currently sitting 5,000 gold behind, but we are starting to see the ornaments arrive. There is an upgraded Aero Pack, which is the name for the Rocket Pack upgrade, and a, I'm looking it up, Typhoon. Typhoon is the upgrade for Gale Force. Ooh. As Nukeduck catches out Melita, and this is what we were saying, the gold card locking, Promise Q gets the kill. Now they're going to try and chase onto Skeens, who is able to flash away. Destiny used by Nukeduck dodges away from the hook. That's a quick pick there for Astralis.
Yeah, very valuable pick as well. I liked what we saw there from Nukeduck, kind of using LeBlanc's strategy against her, sitting in the fog of war, waiting for that opportunity, and once the stun came down, it was a very quick and easy kill. They almost converted it into another one, but they decided not to overcommit. Now they're set up very nicely for the next Drake. Perhaps they can play for the soul, and Nukeduck just kind of threatening with his gold card right now.
Melita 20 seconds away. Dragon up in 30, but no teleport on that LeBlanc means that he will have to meander his way down to the fight rather than being able to teleport into the back line. Jessica still just stepping forward here as Promise Q looks for a flank. It's 4v4 here because White Knight is still pushing in that bottom lane. Zanzara down to about 2/3 HP. Nukeduck stepping back. Going to start clearing out this control ward piece by piece. And I believe Vitality are just going to start to retreat into their own jungle. Melita on his way now. Dragon has spawned. Astralis have the option. You can go for it immediately. And that's what Zanzara is going to start doing here. Is a Vitality will not come to contest.
I think this is the correct play from Vitality. Like, you don't need to force this fight. It's clowned. You know, like, even if Astralis get the soul, you're not going to be at such a disadvantage that the game is suddenly going to be flipped on its head. Of course, it is valuable to Astralis. We already talked about how the added cooldown reduction on all of these ultimates is great. Having the TF ultimate available more often, having Zanzara's ult, White Knight's ult, it just means that they can fight a lot more often. But it's not going to be such a big difference that Vitality's gold lead is suddenly going to disappear. Instead, investing deep vision up towards the top side, you can see some of it being spotted out already, but they've got a lot of great wards here centered around these choke points, which they can now go back and they can look to refresh and restock. But the whole incentive is to play towards this Baron, which is spawning in 45 seconds. So I think Vitality have kind of set up the good framework. Because now when they walk into the river, look at how easy this is, right? There is no vision that they need to clear out because they know that it's already clear. There is some wards in the pit, which they can just very quickly get rid of. So Astralis have to constantly fight their way back into the pit, which is why sometimes fighting for the Drake isn't always the best thing to do.
Yeah, it makes sense. Astralis will gain mid priority as Zanzara was chunked down by Melita once again. I will say, of course, those Cloud Drakes giving ultimate ability haste means that Nukeduck's ultimate is now less than an 80 second cooldown. White Knight's ultimate is now less than a 70 second cooldown. So you just have if we begin having multiple team fights one after the other, if neither team can really gain the upper hand, Astralis will be able to use those ultimates just that little bit more regularly.
I like where the wave state is right now for Vitality. They have that wave pushing in top. Ulti gonna come in mid just to quickly spot out some vision. Again, it's about fighting for mid lane.
Promise Q going in. Call of the Fortress gonna come out and Comp stunned up on the back line. He's not taken down. LeBrov able to survive as well. Both Comp and LeBrov just slivers of an inch away from dying. Astralis able to force them back. And with the bot lane resetting, Astralis very willing to start up this Baron. They're calling Vitality to them, saying, hey, come fight. 3v5, go for us. Promise Q though. Wrong side of the rift, my man.
Oh no, it was such a great engage from Astralis. Forcing the bot lane from Vitality back meant that they could have just started off that Baron and put Vitality in a very tricky situation, but they were not confident in the speed of taking it down. And instead, they end up getting picked off themselves. Malitza and Skins coming up clutch there, finding that kill, and now they're going to be the ones on the Baron. But look at Malitza sitting in the fog of war. He has his eyes on Nuke Duck.
Jessica's here as well. Maybe just go for the AD carry. Instead, he looks for White Knight Burst. Again, they're down to half HP. White Knight the same. Comp, Moonlight Vigil from the side. Gets a little bit of damage. The collateral damage not quite enough. White Knight almost taken out. Zanzara's chased up towards the top side of the fight. Shigenda here. All it takes is a body slam to lock up the horse. Malitza diving in. And Zanzara still surviving for a moment. Malitza flashes to get the kill. Teleport used here in the mid lane as Nuke Duck looks for Comp. Flash, Gold Card, not enough damage, but the Call of the Forge Guard. The Ram will find its home as Comp goes down. And now Vitality are forced away. And Vedius, these team fights continue to develop in this game.
It's definitely becoming a messier game.
I told you
sure.
It would be Mash, Vedius. I promised Mash.
Well, let's have a look at how things went wrong for Vitality here. So a good stun initially onto Comp, and this is what we talked about, the difference between Gale Force and Kraken Slayer. You don't have that additional movement speed, and he loses so much health at the start of the fight. So then Malitza, he's kind of left isolated, and that Gold Card did so much damage, but Comp is able to return the favor onto the tank. Of course, White Knight has the TP, so while all this time is being spent on trying to kill Zanzara, he's able to go back to base, TP back in, and then they use that combination of the TP plus the Twisted Fate ultimate to get this pick onto Comp, who's left isolated in the mid lane. And it kind of ends in disaster. So I like that Astralis was still able to contest this Baron. It does not go in favor of Vitality. The Drake is now going to be spawning in about a minute's time. And Vitality's gold advantage that they did have, you can see how that even though they have this kind of scaling advantage, I think that Astralis still have a lot of tools to be able to answer back. They have a lot of long-range poke, and honestly, they're still finding ways to get onto Comp pretty much in every single fight. Now he doesn't have Flash. He doesn't have Heal either. So if they land those ultimates, if they land those stuns, Comp is in a lot of danger.
And you have to remember, Vedi, because the Dragon was taken earlier by Astralis, they are on Soul Point here. Cloud Soul not too impactful as Promise Q locked up. Call of the Forge Guard coming out. Nuke Duck looking for the Gold Card, but Malitza tries to jump in, and Malitza will be stunned. But already Promise Q is down. Vitality find a pick. As both teams are just, well, they're facing up to each other in the mid lane. I've said that a few times this game. Other lanes haven't really existed for the majority of this one, Betty, as both Astralis and Vitality just want to fight.
Again, it's a lot about contesting for that mid wave. There's no, like, huge advantage, and the lack of, like, any typical mid lane mage makes it harder to contest for those mid waves. You're kind of forced to group everyone up to have numbers priority to be able to gain control. I think the mistake here from Astralis is engaging onto the Gragas. They think that they can just quickly burst him down, but Jessica's not even in range. She doesn't even land an auto. And Gragas, it looks like he gained health in that fight, not actually lost any. I like the flank that came off from Malitza, but he wasn't able to quite land the combo, and then the hook didn't come through from LeBrov either. So it ends up being a quick pick in favor of Vitality. They're the ones that end up securing the Drake. And whew, it still feels like Vitality are in control and Astralis are just finding a couple of good fights, but no fight has ever really swung so massively in one team's favor. But now Astralis are trying to use this brief window to force the Baron. Vitality, I'm not sure if they even know this is going on. Malitza doesn't have the TP.
So they just saw Promise Q place this ward, which means I think they are now. Alarm bells ringing. Alarms going off. We war as they try and come across. Skeen splashes in, but Zanzara's going to secure the Baron. Host going to land on Promise Q, but he's able to run away with the Unbreakable Will. And Astralis, they've just snuck it right under the noses of Vitality.
Very quick thinking there from Astralis. Great utilization of the Twisted Fate ultimate as well. And they were able to just shut that one down before Vitality could even answer. A very small window of opportunity that they were quick to capitalize on. Now, this game is still very close. We talked about it a minute. We knew it was going to be a long one. We knew it was going to be a long one. Of course, Astralis looking to get their first win of the weekend. This is a big proving split for many of the players of Astralis. I think for anyone that's followed the European team for a while, will actually recognize a lot of these names.
Yep.
White Knight, former Unicorns of Love. Promiscue, former G2.
Jesper, former XL.
But yeah, they've been on a number of teams here in the LEC, and they haven't found a lot of success, even received a lot of criticism from both fans and analysts alike. And after working their way back through the regional leagues, they've had a lot of success in the regional leagues, the German leagues, and whatnot. And I think that for them, a lot of these players, they've showcased that they can get better, they can contest. And again, being able to get some of these early wins is very important as the split progresses. And now with the Baron buff, they're looking to siege, but Vitality want to fight.
Moonlight Vigil with the Gravitum, that's a three-man route. Stun card coming out from Nuketuck. Call to the Forge God, dodge to the side as White Knight was knocked back by an explosive
cast. Watch Melissa.
Keep your eyes on the LeBlanc. Curtain call used. Melissa just waiting his time. Hook's going to land on White Knight, but look at the damage already on Shigenda, almost forced away. Melissa still in the right position, still waiting for his opportunity to strike like a cobra on the back line.
Excellent patience coming out from Astralis. I think the way that they were able to disengage there, even after it was a huge ultimate that came through from Comp, and they were able to get away with their lives. It did force the flash out from Jeskler. He respected the possibility of Melissa from coming out of the Fog of War and going for that kill. But he didn't go down. They're still utilizing the Baron to slowly chip away at this tower. The siege continues. The wave clear from Vitality is pretty much only on Comp. So as long as he is still alive, they should be fine. But now Melita on the flank once again. Look at all these flanking wards. They're keeping an eye on where Melita is. But here we are. Hook just misses. The very tense between the two teams is both top and bot, I think, are actually pushing in favor of Vitality right now. Astralis don't care. They don't want to put on the sidelines. They just want to group players five, because that's where they feel much stronger relative to Vitality.
It's the last push. 30 seconds on the Baron buff. The next minion wave has yet to spawn. Promiscue hooked up, knocked back, but has the unbreakable win. But Will becomes very tanky in that moment. Remember, Jeskler, no flash. Melissa with the flank. Hook hits only a minion. Call of the Forge God coming out. The turret about to fall in the mid lane. But Astralis, they can't quite get that last tiny bit of health off it. A stiff breeze would blow down at the tower, but instead Astralis back away. They reset, and it looks like this will be the end of the push with this Baron, but here's the TP. Shigenda doesn't have explosive cast, but he does have a cow in his eyes. Promiscue locked up, the knockback on Shigenda. Lebrov coming forward as well, has the hook. Nuketuck coming in with the Destiny, stun card from the side. Shigenda actually chunked out. And although Vitality were the ones to TP in, they couldn't find the man they were looking for.
Whew. I think a large part of that is because Melita just wasn't with them. He didn't join Shigenda with the teleport. Instead, he chose to reset. We're still
Take a breath.
For a very tense game. Astralis, they gained a lot of ground back. They were able to push through this mid tower, take two of the big, well, the tier one and the tier two, of course, very close to taking the tier three. And now the Drake is going to be spawning very soon. This is one of those Drakes where I strongly believe that if the fight is not good for you, just concede it. I think that while, of course, the soul can be valuable, you never want to just give it up, right? Yep. Free stats are free stats. If you get that additional movement speed, you want it. But I do not think that you should give up the game for this soul. Right now, it seems that Vitality have the priority over the mid lane. They have, for now, a push in the bot wave, and so they can use this window to gain control over the river. They're going to chuck a couple wards down.
Melita looking for the flank once again. Four items on this LeBlanc. Rabadons. Banshee's Veil complete. So powerful right now. And Astralis continue just to look for this mid priority. Melita not really joining with the rest of his team, but you can see now what Vitality trying to do are bring Astralis into this choke point. Pull them down. The Destiny comes out, pops the Banshees on Melita. Dragon goes, there's the soul. They don't know where Melita is. He wasn't seen. Destiny from Nuketuck just back into the mid lane. Vitality have the Cloud Soul on their side now. Shigenda pushing forward, has the explosive cast. If he can find the right position, do the math, do the geometry.
For the top lane, though, a lot of farm just being lost to that tower, but they don't care. They're eyeing each other up in the mid lane. Ulti comes through onto White Knight.
Cask has been used. Here's the Call of the Forge God. Ooh. Only onto Skeen's Nuketuck. Almost nuked out, but not quite. Still able to survive. Does have TP coming off cooldown soon with that unsealed spellbook. Comp still stepping forward. Infernum Gravitum. Well, he can do a lot of AoE damage if he finds the right fight, but instead Vitality push down the mid lane.
Whew. Okay, so Vitality, they do get themselves the soul. They will have that additional movement speed. And they were very close to getting a kill onto Nuketuck. I'm not entirely sure where the damage even came from. Wasn't sure if it was Melita or Comp, but either way, Now Vitality have this brief window where they get to set up a little bit of control over the river. A lot of their vision was invested initially towards the bot side, so they had to reset. And it's actually Zanzara that gets to the top river first. You can see that in terms of itemization, he has kind of fallen a little bit behind that of Skeens. Level 18 on the Graves for 1 and 2. He also is a huge damage threat. Like, just look at his itemization. So much crit coming out from this Graves. And now we were talking about how Vitality's comp like scales extremely well. This Graves is a large part of that.
Nuke Dunk looking to the flank here, straight onto LeBron.
Good hook.
Oh, just lollipops off to the side of it. Shigenda has to go golden because he's now in the midst of four members of Astralis. Ooh. Tries to flash away, but Promiscue is there with the knockup. And look at White Knight off towards the side, keeping LeBron, keeping comp at arm's reach. Astralis get a kill, and they will turn their eyes towards this Baron.
Wow, I thought that Nuke Dunk was going to die there. The moment that that hook landed, I thought that Astralis were done for. But thanks to the choke point, Astralis were actually able to turn it around in their favor. The control ward comes down in place of the lantern, and they were able to get the, not the kill onto Shigenda, but they turn it around onto LeBrov instead. Now, gold card comes through, good damage onto Shigenda.
There is the curtain call. Shigenda's gonna fall at the start of the fight. Promise Q almost gets down as well. Will, in the end, get taken out. Zanzara going back onto comp, but the cleanse, the moves. Look at comp trying to escape from this fight. He's rooted up with a deadly flourish, and now he is in no man's land. Shut down by Nuke Dunk. Astralis, still four players left alive.
Yeah, it's 4v2. Skeens and Melitza, they don't have the HP. Oh, but it looks like Astralis are making the call to just go and end it. Bit of a weird TP from White Knight, but you know what? Don't care. Not going to question it right now. He has the minion wave. The second TP, this one makes a little bit more sense. Nukta, gone back to base. We'll spend a little bit of that gold. They have four members alive. LeBrov has just respawned. Shigenda is 20 seconds away. Can Astralis end it?
We've had some bangers and we've had some mash, Bedius, and Astralis are looking for their just desserts, trying to take their first win in the LEC. First Nexus Tower's down. White Knight diving in as they try and catch on Skeens. Jesco was hooked up and he gets the shutdown. And now it's only LeBrov and Melitza left alive. Melitza underneath the tower trying to do what he can, but he's done for as well. Astralis, at the third time of asking, will take their first win in the LEC.
Whew. You know, I wasn't expecting the game to go that way. We were talking at about like 30 minutes how it was just kind of a matter of time for Vitality to just kind of close things out. They had a really healthy gold lead. Like, they had taken down, they had such a huge tower advantage. All they needed was the next Baron into them looking to end the game. But the game got quite chaotic. It was just kind of picks coming back and forth. And, you know, when it came down to these final team fights, Astralis just ultimately executed better. And it feels like that we're seeing these reoccurring problems now for Vitality where they clearly have very strong laners.
Yeah.
Their players are very talented, but when it comes to the mid to late game decision making, it is difficult for them to close out games. We saw it against Schalke and are seeing it again against Astralis. And while that initial potential does seem to be there for Vitality, they really need to clean up some of their play, because I feel like that was a game that was in their grasp that they kind of let go.
It definitely was. And on the other side of the rift, Astralis picking up their first win. And you can vote for one of them as a key player of the game. Either Zanzara, Nuke Dunk, or Jeskla are your options. And I do want to just give a little bit of credit to Promise Q as well, because it was him who was initiating a lot of the fights. Like, he went in. Yes, yeah. He died a lot of the time. But I think that's what Vitality missed at times. Like, they didn't have someone who was
Promise Q gave a lot of the advantages to Vitality. So I'm kind of like,
the game was so back and forth. I didn't say I wanted him to be
MVP here from Zanzara in just a few minutes as Astralis got their first win in the LEC. These support mains, support mains.
They are out there, waiting to be discovered. Some of them are big, and some of them are small. But that's the thing with ideas. They don't just come to you. To find them, you have to move. Kia, movement that inspires.
chant against me. I can calculate 90 trillion moves in advance. Not fair. Not fair.
Red Bull gives you wings.
Welcome back to the LEC, everyone. Astralis with the first win. And I don't know if you followed Twitter yesterday, but Zanzara told me he wouldn't go through week one without getting an interview. So Zanzara, welcome.
I'm glad to have you interviewed today.
Hi. Finally, your first win. What was different today compared to the other two games you played?
I mean, we won today. This is different. So. I think it's like this is the main difference, right? But we could have won more games. But I think we kind of misplayed. I kind of didn't play that well. The second game for sure could have forced like more versus Mad Lions. But third one, we didn't hesitate. We just go for plays, even if it's a bad play, good play. We just go, and it is what it is. And actually, it's ended up as a win, so I'm happy.
It is good to try things in the end, and I want to believe that the fact that you guys follow each other, even if it's through bad plays, means that you guys trust each other already, right?
No, we're like okay, he go in, we just go in too. Like, okay, I mean, we don't think, you know, it's not a trust, you know, I would not call it. I think just like, okay. We're just crazy, you know, like as a five. We just, okay, I mean, he's in sync, we're gonna eat with him, right? So like, they can flame us all, you know? Like, so like not one guy, you know, responds for the loose in our team. We just like all in, you know, all in together then. Right? But this game is fine because like Vitality inted a little bit more. So this was perfect for us. Then like if enemy team is more than us, then we can win. This is good.
I think it's a good approach. Try and get the ints out of the other teams by inting yourself. That's not a tactic I've seen before. I appreciate it. But you're gonna face off against G2 next week. We know the int potential coming from this team, but we also know how good they are. So talk me through this matchup and how you hope it's gonna go for you.
I don't know. I just hope like G2 will do like G2 things as always, like full disrespect us, just do crazy stuff, like pick random picks, do like I don't know, optimistic plays over and over, and we just snowball through that, and this is how it's gonna be. Because I mean, everyone know what like G2 will not take probably as seriously, just will test some picks as always early season. So G2 is a flip, and it's like more than possible to win, I think.
Who knows, maybe if you're lucky, Jankos will play Nidalee and then it's a free win for you guys. But I'm talking more about you. Rogue tweeted something yesterday mentioning the Church of Zanzara. I want to know more. What is the Church of Zanzara?
It started because I was just too good. I was just too good for Polish League, and they have to make a meme, and I just accepted. I said thank you very much. I just like appreciate it. And right now, when I'm doing good plays, but I'm always doing good plays, so like everyone just spamming this on Twitter. I'm happy with it.
All right, let's remember the Church of Zanzara then when you put out the big plays like you did today. But thank you very much for this first interview, and hopefully we talk to each other next week.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Have fun and see you soon. And for the rest of you, we're going to take a short break and we'll come back in a few minutes for SK Gaming versus... I don't have it. Rogue, is it? See you soon.